Happy Sabbath once again, and a happy day of rest. We are impressed by the blessings that Jesus Christ bestowed on this day as the Sabbath. And today, being our music week, we are going to basically focus on Jesus Christ as the main center of our redemption. As the main center of our redemption. Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving that you may guide us into this session as we learn about your name. We shall have sessions of music, we shall have sessions of scripture, but all in all we pray that you may guide accordingly. In Jesus' name I pray. We read from the book of Revelation chapter 12, verse 10, and it says that, I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of Christ, for the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before God day and night. This verse has two parts. There's a part of rejoicing, and there's a part of the reason as to why we are rejoicing. This being a music Sabbath, most of the sermon is going to include music. We are going to be singing more than talking. And the first one, I want to remind you that we are into the presence of God, and we are on the holy ground. When I walk through the door, I sensed his presence. Then I knew this was the place where love abounds. For this is the temple Jehovah God abides here, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground. All around, let us praise Jesus now, for we are standing in his presence on holy ground. In his presence there is joy beyond all measure, and at his feet peace of mind can still be found. And if you have a need, I know he has the answer. Reach out to him, for we are standing on holy ground.
We can join in the chorus.
We are and We are going to talk about the story of the Messiah. That's the story of Jesus Christ. The story of Jesus Christ starts from the beginning when there was war in heaven. The reason for Jesus coming here is to save the sinful race. From Revelation chapter 12, verse 7, we see that there was war in heaven, and Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. It says, and prevailed not. The dragon did not prevail. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. So the reason Jesus Christ is coming is because there was disobedience in heaven. And when you see, during that meeting in heaven, there was a decision that was made. This is what we call the great controversy. Those who have got a chance to read that book, you'll find that there. When we read in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, we are not going to open so much because I detailed almost everything. You just have a pen and a piece of paper, you note them down. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then I said, the I is Jesus Christ, said, here am I, send me. In that statement, we have a song that sings about that scenario, which is, hark the voice of Jesus calling, and we shall get a key from the pianist and have that song. Hark the voice of Jesus calling. That's hymn 359. We too need to hearken to the Lord's voice, and we have to decide and say that here we are so that the Lord may use us. We'll use the first stanza and the second stanza.
Away, Lord and Lord.
purpose for Jesus coming and the way Jesus came on this earth was a mysterious one, which was even proclaimed before it happened. The incarnation of Jesus Christ is the process whereby the holiness gets into humanity for salvation. This is when Jesus Christ came from his heavenly throne to the sinful world to save the sinful race. We shall read Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. The incarnation is when the heavens came down to earth to fill mankind. Being born after the prophecy of Prophet Isaiah, which is stipulated in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, which says, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and he shall call his name Emmanuel," which means the Lord with us. And the Lord steps down to the sinful world to redeem his people of the rest that had fallen. We shall go through the birth of Jesus Christ and see how it happened. When we recall from Scripture how Jesus Christ came to this world, he was born by a virgin woman, was proclaimed. And his birth took place in a sacred place, isn't it? Christ's birth took place in a sacred place, isn't it? No, it was a sacred place. It was one of the places where you would never wish to be born. It was a miserable moment whereby even they had planned to kill all the baby bones that are being born then. But since it was the design of salvation, Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem. The story continues after the incarnation of Jesus Christ. When we read from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, that is when the promise was fulfilled. "For unto us the child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." Hark the herald's angels singing, "Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy may." You know that song? Let's sing the first stanza of that song. Hark the herald's angels singing, all of us. Hark the herald's angels singing, glory to the new. As we continue to see the life of Jesus after being born, he started his ministry. And his ministry started in a weird way, where he ran away from home, in quotes, and went where they found him. And they asked him where he was. And he answered them that, don't you know that I'm supposed to be on my father's ministry? I'm paraphrasing. During his life on earth, he cared for the poor. He healed the sick. He never turned away the little children. His love is endless. It's available for all of us. Jesus told that we must forgive. He loved and ministered by giving, and this is why his name is known almost all over the world, because of his deeds. And he comes to us and tells us the same, that we should minister unto others the way he ministered to the least of these. But even though he did these acts of kindness to all that he had met, he was crucified at the end of it all. He was crucified on the old rugged cross, on that hill that was far away, Golgotha. On that rugged cross where we meet our salvation. On the hill far away where stood that old rugged cross as the emblem of suffering and shame. But I love that old rugged cross where rest and best of the lost sinners was slain. So I cherish the old rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a cross. Alas, then be my Savior, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred hand for sinners such as I? Laid at Calvary, each and every year that comes, we remember Calvary. Each and every year we spend in our lives, each and every time we spend in our lives,
whatsoever we do is vanity if we do not reflect at the cross of Calvary.
Yes, I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not he was for me, he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. By God's word, alas, my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the Lord I spoke, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary.
Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan.
Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty God that God is planned at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Oh, and now I've given to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy that was great and grace was free.
Oh,
pardon that was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Mercy that was great and grace was free at Calvary. Calvary.
After 3 days, as it was prophesied, Jesus Christ rose from the dead. He is not there, for he is risen, as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. He is risen. He is risen from the dead. I serve a risen Savior who is in the world today. And I know that he is living whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he is always there. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Is any one of you weary? Tell it to Jesus. Is any one of you anxious about tomorrow? Tell it to Jesus. Is any one of you bothered of anything? Are you downhearted? Are you pressed by the world's endeavors? Are you in the deep sorrow, in the depth of decision, of which way to follow? The only answer is follow Jesus. James 5:13 tells us that, is any one of you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of the faith shall have the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sin, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. That was James chapter 5, verse 13 to 16. As we come to the close of this session, we shall read Psalms 100, and we have a closing hymn, and then we shall set off for lunch. Psalms 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, not we our own. We are his people and the sheep of his pastures. And he calls us to come into his presence with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise, and be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord, his mercies and his truth through all generations.